Welcome to EdScoop TV. I'm Wyatt Kash, and we're here today with John Harrington, CEO for Funds for Learning. John, welcome to the program.
Thank you.
So, John, I know that you've taken a particular interest in how schools can take advantage of the FCC's E-rate program mm-hmm. and really help boost their infrastructure and broadband support. And we also know right now that we're sort of at a time of transition with the new administration, and there's obviously a lot of questions about what will happen with E-rate funds, and we'd like to hear some of your thoughts on what you're hearing so far and what you might advise schools to think about,
sure.
and libraries as well, I'm sure.
Yeah, well, you know, a couple things. First of all, the demand for broadband internet access in schools and libraries is exploding, and schools and libraries turn to the E-rate program as their primary source for funding to help them get those faster connections into their classrooms or their library facilities. And so it's understandable right now that there's also some concern about that critical source of funding, and will it continue to be there as schools and libraries are planning. And as is the nature of so many things in Washington, D.C., reform, changes to regulations, sort of has a geological time frame associated with it. You know, a couple of years ago, we were really active involved in the last reform of the E-rate program. Mm-hmm. And that whole process took about 3 years to get the E-rate modernization implemented that in 2015. And so I expect that over the course of the next few years, there will be some changes to the E-rate program. But those changes are in the 2019, 2020 timeframe, and they're not the sort of things that are just are going to kind of drop out of nowhere in the middle of the night. It's a very meticulous, mm-hmm. very detailed procedure that the FCC has to follow, and all the information we hear out of the new FCC is very supportive of broadband in general for schools and libraries.
Mm-hmm. You recently released a report indicating that the initial application activity in 2017 seems to be at a somewhat faster pace mm-hmm. Than we saw in 2016. Any sense for either why that is? Are schools maybe better trained on how to go through the process, or are they just that much more interested in getting these funds to build out these programs?
Well, I'd say it's a little bit of both. I don't know that they're more interested. Certainly, though, the pressure is on schools and to get these connections in place. They're looking for a faster connection between their facilities or in their classroom buildings. And it's a good problem to have, but it's a serious problem. The teachers, the students are beginning to embrace these technologies, and all of a sudden they've got to get faster connections. And so that is the sort of the basic framework that these schools are operating in. And so now here comes the E-rate application process, and in some ways it's sort of the best of taxes and mortgage paperwork and insurance reimbursements, you know, just sort of put all those things together, and that's what they have. It's mm-hmm. It's a lot of deadlines and forms. It can be a little confusing, overwhelming. And on top of that, about a year and a half ago, the administrator of the program, USAC, implemented a new online system
right.
to help streamline the process. It's called EPC, and it's been a bit of a challenge. They've had to iron out a lot of wrinkles, and they're still in the process of doing that. But a lot of the wrinkles have been ironed out.
Mm-hmm.
And so this year, it's going a little more smoothly for applicants than it did last year. And so, mm-hmm. yeah, we are seeing more applications getting in the door faster, and we hope that will ultimately translate to faster funding commitments, which then the schools and the libraries can go out and actually take advantage of.
Mm-hmm. Talk a little about what you see in the mix of what schools are applying for. As more and more schools now have broadband access, they've sort of shifted probably to to support their internal Wi-Fi expansion mm-hmm. and connectivity. What have you seen changing in the last year or so, and how do you see that changing over the next couple of years as more schools become more fully equipped?
The conversation has shifted from getting connected to capacity. You know, for years we were talking about the need to get classrooms connected, to get those libraries connected. And by and large, those connections are there. The challenge is now about capacity. Mm-hmm. And school districts that we work with, even those that we consider very progressive, they were really out there in terms of getting capacity into their classrooms. What they're finding is that it's an almost impossible exponential curve to stay ahead of. Mm-hmm. That the demand for these tools, these resources, when students realize that there's these media-rich resources out there, when teachers see the power of those types of applications and that content, they're embracing it. And it's doubling, tripling, quadrupling. And so the real trend I see over the next few years, it's all about capacity. You've got schools that had Wi-Fi and they had their whole campus covered. And they're discovering now that instead of all those access points being enough, they're having to go in and get an access point in each classroom. Or they already had an access point in each classroom, but now they need the faster, the newer technology because what they had just isn't up to speed, mm-hmm. so to speak.
Yeah. And what do you see on the provider side, the carriers, the installers in various districts? Are you seeing shifts in that landscape as well as through the E-rate program?
Yeah, I think that we've seen actually an uptick in activity in service providers that are sort of rising to the challenge, accepting the challenge, the call to help these schools. As a part of the reform that passed in 2015, the FCC returned funding for on-campus connections, so the wireless access points. And so there's been a bit of a learning curve for service providers who had for several years not been really active in the program. They've been responding to the competitive bidding process that schools have to go through. So we're seeing an uptick in service providers submitting proposals, and what that's doing is it's driving pricing down, and it's also opening the door, I think, to new solutions. And mm-hmm. I expect to see over the next few years that there'll be even new technologies, new solutions. When the E-rate program started, there wasn't such a thing as Wi-Fi. There was no Wi-Fi when the E-rate program started, and so you don't have to look back too far to see that these things shift quickly. And I expect that 2-3 years from now, we're going to be struggling with, okay, where does this technology fit into the eligible services framework? Because it doesn't neatly fit into this category or this category, but yet service providers are bringing this new solution to the table to help the schools or the libraries stay connected.
Mm-hmm. And then doubling back finally to the FCC, still some uncertainty there with the current makeup of mm-hmm. the commission. Can you give us your sense for what to watch for in the coming months with the makeup of the commissioners and also in light of Chairman Pai's decision with the Lifeline program mm-hmm. of kind of blocking these nine companies from participating in subsidized broadband mm-hmm. delivery? Obviously got concerned, have some schools concerned about their ability to execute. Any advice you have of what to watch for in the months ahead?
Well, I think that the first thing I would say is it's so important to let people know, let the FCC know, let representatives in Congress know how important these funds are. Mm. So the first thing I would be listening for, or watching for, is not at the FCC, but really at the grassroots level. Mm-hmm. It's vital that we give that feedback to the FCC. Let them know that this is not just something that is sort of on the side. Mm-hmm. The E-rate program, because it's supporting these vital connections, are really front and center in almost every school district and every library system in the country. So
yes.
Making sure that the FCC understands the true scope of the impact of the program, mm-hmm. I think is something we can all be doing. And then at the FCC, I think it's important to watch, listen for what they're doing. A lot of the words they've said are the right words. So it's really to watch their actions over the next few months and see if they do release, for example, a notice that they're looking at new rules. Mm-hmm. We can look at that for clues as to what their thoughts are, and then there's a reply process and a whole regulatory structure built around making sure that the public has an opportunity to share their voice and to speak into those new regulations.
Well, terrific. Well, hey, John, thank you so much for stopping by, sharing some of your insights and observations about the E-Rate program and offering some ideas of what to be watching for next. So we really appreciate it.
Absolutely.
Great. I'm Wyatt Kash with EdScoop TV. Thanks for tuning in.